shush.
Hi.
Oh no,
my name's James. I'm part of Harlow Arts Trust. Been involved in Harlow for a couple of years. And I'd like to introduce.
Hang on a second, sorry.
Yeah, I'd like to introduce this evening and just give you a little context of why we're here. So, Finn is our inaugural stair. Sculpture Town Artist in Residence.
Excuse me, I can't actually hear you. It's in a terrible place. He's standing. I can't hear you properly.
Oh, okay.
Can we?
Everyone, is everyone in the back?
Well, yeah. Just me.
Yeah. I think it might just be you.
Come and sit in the front.
Don't you go to the back.
I'll bring you the chair.
Take this one.
That's ruined my mind.
Oh, what are we doing? One by one.
That's free now.
We've got our feet.
I don't know.
So, yes, we, Harlow Arts Trust, we wanted to, in short terms, in layman's terms, reinvigorate the sculpture collection that's already here. In 2009, Harlow was designated Sculpture Town of Britain. It was a little known fact that was really only known in sort of 10-mile radius outside of Harlow. And we really wanted to sort of open up Harlow to the rest of the country and say, let us know we're really here. And one of the pilot projects we had on the go was the stairs, Sculpture Town Artists in Residence. And it is for a graduating student of the RCA Sculpture course. We go to the Harlow Arts Trust, we go to the end of year show, and we choose 3 to 5 artists, which we do. Then we have an interview a week later, and then on the day we pick a candidate. And Finn was the lucky one. He was a unanimous vote. We all chose him. I think it was the eyes myself. and he said he liked my work. So, yeah. But anyway, it's a 16-month residency running from September to the following year, December. It includes a studio at Aquifer Studios, a gatehouse in the middle of the town. There's small subsistence and travel bursaries, not enough to do much on, but enough to get here. Also in partnership with Harlow College, obviously the Royal College of Art, and Pearson's, who are the main funders for this project. We've already got our second stair in progress, Paloma Proudfoot. She started in September, and we have funding for a third one in place. And our idea is maybe we could do 10 over the next 10 years and create a new legacy of sculpture. We've still yet to decide, but part of the residency is that the artist will donate a piece to the Arts Trust, and that way we'll build up a new legacy of sculpture for the town. And yeah, just word of mouth really, just talk about Harlow. So yeah, I'd like to introduce local artist on good, Cedric Christie. Mr. Richard Wentworth, and the man of the moment, Finn.
Okay, so the way I think we're going to do this is just start talking, and I think it was quite important to talk for James to kind of introduce the project, because it's rare that you get this kind of amount of time that you know you're going to be somewhere. And when I came to Harlow, it was really strange to be able to see. There's a kind of way of looking that you can read about and talk to kind of academics about looking at these post-war new towns. So like the word utopia is used a lot, and art and design is used a lot for kind of working class people and also mixing up classes. And after the war, there was this kind of optimism which seemed to kind and romanticism which kind of manifested in a new kind of town creation to try and shape the way people moved and lived in a kind of modern way. And then along with that, there's also a kind of way of speaking of like failure or what's happened to that environment. And I was quite aware of that, not super aware, but that was the way some people kind of spoke about it. So I thought it was going to be quite interesting to see how I felt about it. And it kind of took me quite a while to develop my own view on what that meant. And I think it's a quite dangerous way of continuing to talk, because for the most part, I think there's if you continue to look back on that kind of 50s model as a relic, then it's quite it's not very inspiring to the people who are living here or the children who are trying to be creatives and affect their own environment if their environment's being seen as a 50s like experiment. So that was good in terms of like when you looked at the residency kind of layout and there were like the educational program, which is the classic thing, and you're a bit like, oh, maybe that's a kind of tick boxing thing, but it became really important to the project. And just walking through Harlow, like walking gives you so much information because of how much was done in some periods of time. Like it's, you can really see the idea behind what they were trying to do and what they failed at doing, what they succeeded in doing, which is sometimes like living in London, that's a bit more complicated and layered. You kind of need to be an art historian or an architecture boff to kind of navigate that environment. But yeah, so these, all of this work has kind of come out of a way of trying to look at seeing, like, I think sculpture, like, it's always hard because I don't really want to make art about art, but there was a great way in for me in with Harlow, because it didn't feel, I didn't want to make a kind of cultural presumptions, but at the same time I managed to be very daring through the like sculpture program. So instead of kind of not using art, I kind of used art as a tool to then be quite I could be cheeky in that world, which was quite useful. And so yeah, I like to think the show looks at a bit on the past, but also kind of the possibilities of what public means, not just within art, but I don't know, is there anything?
Do you know everybody here?
I know everyone's, nearly everyone's faces, yeah.
Because I would feel much more, I recognise too many people here. and I'd love to, are there some people here who actually live in Harlow? And is there somebody who's lived here for, we'll start with, is there anyone living in Harlow for 30 years? 40? 50? I know how far I can go, 60? Well, I mean, that's incredible. I think it's really important because that's the definition of lived experience. And I'm 70, and it's as old, it starts pretty much as I'm born. So I'm twinned. and I think it's quite different. You know, we live quite near each other in Knockabout. I actually don't know where you live, but you're from the patch.
Awesome.
Yeah. So we live in the piece of London that was more or less, I don't know whether they use the ugly term decant, but I'm sure some of you know it does. Actually, I'm going to risk saying this because maybe everybody doesn't know this, but my understanding of the New Towns is that at the beginning of the war, Churchill was specifically incredibly anxious, being basically a warmonger.
he was extremely anxious that London, he described London as a cow with tethered calves, ready to be assaulted, because London was so industrial, because basically it was a port, and it processed stuff. And then, as a general rule, I think Jamaican sugar would come to London, be processed and sent back. You want to start to have a slight sense of what the British Empire might have been. That's the process. You can make a lot of money doing that, but it's clearly daft. So that anxiety about how London was organised, which was something that had come out of the 19th century, made it super vulnerable, as we found out in 1940. And the origin of the new towns was very much to take that industry out of London and put it in places that were less obviously vulnerable and less obviously connected. This may be, I don't think it's a complete invention, but there'll be somebody here who knows better. And I've always been very interested in the idea that there were people like Orwell who went to work during the war in the basement of Senate House in what is now, well, what was then London University. And so that could be some of you guys, you know, intelligent, probably men, because perhaps the women weren't invited, and sat around and said, this country is crap. It, you know, it cheated everyone in the First War. And while it was cheating everyone in the First War, it killed whatever it would be, 30% of the people who were involved. Then it comes the Russian Revolution, then there's anxiety all through the 20s, then there's the crash, so no one has any work, so everybody's got their own version of this, but life is crap. And then nothing was done for anyone in Britain. That's why the 30s are so dark. Up until, obviously there were people who were concerned about it, but there is very little evidence of any proper action. So that the people who cared, people who minded, were the people who were in the basement of Senate House in whatever that would be, 40, 41, going, what are we going to do about this? And I know there are people here who can say, well, you got that a bit wrong, but I just wanted to be sure we might all be starting from something a bit similar. And that leads to Abercrombie making, am I right in saying that the map of London is known as the liver map? Or all the shapes, in 1943, they publish a map of how London should be with the motorway box on it. And all sorts of pieces of London which you know or have heard of. You know, Bermondsey appears as a sort of rather nice, sort of modernist shape. It's no longer geography, it's a kind of blob. And it's the beginning of what I would say is a group of people beginning to want to be modern, and that's going to come into, I'm assuming that everybody here is interested in the subject, so when I say us, I mean, that's why we're here, because you can't be here tonight by accident. And this map of London was made, and that included the satelliting of the new towns. And I think that English education is so poor that mostly one doesn't, I know that from sort of buying secondhand books and reading, I'm not a good academic student, but I know enough about where that impetus comes from. And we sort of kept doing that until we built Grenfell. We sort of stopped because of, really probably because of the oil crisis. Is there anyone here who's an economist? See, there never is. No, because you need somebody to say, you can't do this now because you haven't got that to do it with, and maybe you like the idea of this, or you voted to do this, but it isn't going to work. It just does. But if you examine the early 70s, you can see that it's over. You can see there's a sequence of events that include Ireland, the oil crisis, Yom Kippur War. Surprise, surprise, Nixon goes to China. What do you suppose that was about? How come that China had been put asleep by the West for, 400 years? So that's the beginning of China being, oh, you can wake up, you know, we can, you know, we'd like to make some cars for us or whatever. And that's all happening in the first 5 years of the 70s. And I think that's where a lot of, I don't know if this is what you wanted to talk about tonight, but I think that's where a lot of the ill feeling that we all share at the moment, not necessarily towards each other, but the anxiety we share at the moment, I think it's all rooted in the complete failure to make imaginative decisions in the early 70s. Meanwhile, Harlow probably was thriving until you were how old? It's your turn.
Yeah, sure. That's good. Harlow was thriving. I grew up in Harlow, and it possibly was thriving. You know, all of my mates, that some of them are here, when we left school, we either left school, signed on, and then went straight to apprenticeship colleges. But it wasn't no unemployment.
We had the year.
Oh, God. 77.
My mate just told me.
No, but it was. And it was thriving. And I remember thinking about that, thinking about the way Harlow's changed, but what it was like when I grew up. And it was a magical place. It was brilliant. We you know, kids were allowed, you know, you called everyone auntie, you were allowed to do things and get hurt. And it was just like you were able to live. And one of the aspects that's happened to me is that what I found in, like, growing up in Harlow, not understanding art at all when I was living in Harlow, and then getting my first commission to make a sculpture, remembering not being able to spell the word sculpture, and then kind of going into this space where it wasn't new for me, but what made it doable was coming from Harlow, because it meant I could just act as I only knew, which meant I wasn't lost. So it gave me an amazing confidence to people that were kind of not used to me or being spoken to in a certain way that was just completely, you know, like people talk to me and I go, what's that word mean? I don't know. And they go, what do you mean? I go, I don't know. And then people would do little jokes and go, well, you didn't have a classical education. I go, no, I didn't. You know what I mean? Like, what the fuck with classical education? You know, and you get that. And so I was able to kind of navigate my way within this other space, which was new to me because I came from Harlow. Whereas if I hadn't come from Harlow and I'd come from somewhere else, I don't know what I would have been or how I would have been perceived or been. I had a confidence. Harlow gave me a confidence. And I don't know why it did, but it just did. It was just like, that's how it is. It just is. You know, you want that, you do that. You don't do that, you won't get that. It was straightforward. And so you see someone go, oh, that's really nice. Can I have it? No, fair enough. But do you know what I mean? And that, so for me, Harlow was amazing. It was amazing because of that. But then you get into this different space where people talk about the new towns in a different way. You know, I kind of grew up where you want to decorate your car and you want to put colours on it and then you go, oh, what an idiot. You see a car like that, all painted up, and you go, what an idiot. And you go, actually, he's just expressing himself. And the problem is most of you have got a car and the only thing you do is clean it. Do you know what I mean? You wouldn't put anything on it. But when you see someone that does do that, you kind of want to laugh at them as if they're stupid. And then you want to go, yeah, but I want to express myself in this way. And so Harlow was kind of, it gave me a really good grounding to move into another space.
That reminds me a bit of the, there's an artwork in Milton Keynes, which they're just concrete cows. Mm. And they've been used so much for public expression in that people have been allowed to just graffiti on them, change them. And over the last 50 years, people have done, there's a list of things that people have done to these cows, which is unbelievable. But that, like, kids do that, because, like, there are these three archive images that I found online, and that's of Barbara Hepworth and these two kids just graffitiing it, going, and they write "just married"
right
on it. And
oh, they're like a Barbara Hepworth.
Yeah, and they're just two, it's just an housing estate, and they're two big lumps of rock, and the kids were just married on it, which, that's pretty good.
I don't know, it's quite tricky, isn't it, because there's this idea of judgment, and there's this idea that you obtain a position or an environment which gives you an ability to judge others or make a judgment on the other environments that you're not part of. And the scary thing is that judgment becomes truth, because you sit with a certain group of people that are very much like you, all kind of going nodding in the same way. Then when you leave the room, no one's questioned anything. They've just gone, oh yeah, they're all like that over there. And that, you find that quite scary. And I think...
And until this evening, I didn't, until 20 minutes ago, I'd never heard that.
And then?
No, really not. So I wonder, I mean...
Do you agree with it?
Well, I think I'm probably in the eldest 10 people in the room, I'm in that group.
Yeah.
Okay. And one of the things that I think that I come to understand is how episodic our lives are. We talked about it earlier. Stuff happens and it's sequential.
Yeah.
But you can't see it's sequential. You don't, you're just living a cheesy life. You don't really understand why things are taking. You have desire X and it comes out as act Y, success, failure, whatever. So it's that, I mean, as I understand it, children are told if they do A, B, and C at the moment, they will have a career. You know, to me, a career is the thing you leave behind in a German toilet when you turn around. It's the thing that the Germans want to look at. It's the thing that you leave in the toilet. It's the thing that you produce, but you leave behind. That's a career. Career is very hard to say, I'm going to do this and this and this. And maybe there is somebody here who's on their career, well, good luck to you. But I think it's unusual to achieve that because lives are made of eventuality. And those eventualities or those lives take place in places. So this is historically rural.
Mm.
This is kind of wheat lands coming into London or London coming out and buggering up the wheat lands. It's off into East Anglia. And you know, when people talk about what is London, I would say London is Norwich to Birmingham to Bristol to Southampton. It's 25 million people. It's an economy of 25 million people, half of whom were on the train with me tonight, going in and out. And the thing that I think gets pointed at unfairly is probably architecture. Because it's the quickest thing that people can point at and sneer at. When in fact, it's because we can't see in front of ourselves. Humans can't see in front of ourselves. So we could do a memory game now. No one's going to make a very good job beyond about 15 years back. And the younger people can make quite a poor job of that because they don't have any distance on it. So the piece of memory where you can be kind of reasonably accurate and say, well, that, you know, this happened then and that happened then, is probably quite good for that sort of amount of time. After that, it's there, if you're fortunate. And we're expected to propel forwards to live our lives. That's why we walk forwards. We try not to walk backwards. And we can't see enough ahead. So any judgments that might be made about Harlow would be that all of that goodwill from 1947 with a few adjustments, that can't satisfy. I mean, we're living in a time of.
But
I'm
I don't
gonna,
think
I'm
it's.
Shut up. It's the last sentence. The last sentence. It's when we went out, I was thinking, oh my God, we're walking through disposable time and disposable income.
Mm.
So people are very worried about money, but they spend it on burgers and exactly what we did.
Yeah.
Because that's how, and we were walking in winter wonderland. We were in Matalan and wherever, and that became the culture. And that culture simply didn't exist 60 years ago. You know, the most you could hope for was to go and buy a penny chew. I'm being simplistic.
Yeah, no, but I'm thinking that if you're in a group, what I'm trying to say that if you're in a group of people that already agree with you, okay. So my personal hate here, right, is Radio 4. Okay, I can't stand the Guardian.
Only in Harlow.
Only in Harlow, but I can't stand the Guardian or Radio 4 because Audie agrees with you. And so you watch people listening to it or reading it, and it's just like patting yourself on the back. It's just like going, oh, yeah, look, you were right. And I remember a friend of mine in Harlow, the black guy gets the police knocks on his door, and they knock on his door and they say, is Mr. Lawrence here? And he's gone, why? And they're going, you've been getting lots of right-wing information, you know, pamphlets and that, and we want to talk to you about it. And there's this big black guy, and they go, is that you? And he goes, yeah. And they go, why are you doing that? And he's going, well, because I like reading it. And I remember having a conversation with him, and he said, and I go to, why are you doing this? And he goes, because the only way for me to gain any knowledge of anything is to read what the people that don't like me are reading. If I'm reading what all they agrees with me, I'm not going to grow. I'm just going to be part of the problem. So when I was saying about within our groups, you'll see it. You'll get in a group of Carby people or your group, and you'll all agree, or you'll be upset that someone doesn't agree, and the person who doesn't agree is an idiot. But in fact, that is what I find really interesting. And Harlow enabled me to do that more than a lot of my friends who grew up in London or educated differently that can't do that. You know, they're just not able to question their own self about where they are. So I do think it's quite, for me, it's been really important to kind of be able to mix with like some extremely right-wing people, extremely rich, extremely not, and be able to pick things and listen to them and argue with them and work out and go back and go, oh, Cedric, you're such an idiot. How come you didn't see that? Of course you need to do that. Or, I used to argue with my wife about recycling. And she go, and she recycle, and I go, I'm not recycling. She goes, why? I go, because my best friend owns a waste management company, and he told me they're just burying it anyway. So I'm not recycling. And then one day she said to me, but if you respect me, I want to recycle. So I'm going, oh, fuck. Because you do. But there's a problem here, because I know it's not going. I'm going, call him. Jason would tell you, we're just burying it. He goes, we can't afford to do what needs to do with it. So, but she goes, I need to believe it can be done. And so, you know, I used to go to the bin and have this moment every time. Like, I know my common sense tells me it doesn't matter, but my wife, who I love, is telling me it matters to her. And so you have to kind of stretch somewhere. But it's that questioning thing that I find with lots of people who I've come across, it's not able to. You know, it's not able to. Some people I come across, I say to them, well, of course you're right, because everyone around you're paying them.
But is this to do with Harlow?
Well, it is to do with Harlow, because for me, it gave me that confidence, because I meet lots of people who didn't come from Harlow, who kind of don't have that, and I'm going, I'm not that special. The only thing I can put it down to is that I come from goddamn Harlow. It's not because I went to this school or did that, or my parents did that. It's because I've met people that will call a spade, treat it like it was at that moment. And so, it's, for me, the other day I was in Italy or somewhere, and this guy's doing a book on Basildon about a photography club. And I'm going, do you know anything about Basildon? And no. I'm going, well, what are you doing a book on Basildon for? And so he ends up asking me to talk about it. I'm going, why am I talking about it? You don't even, you know, I don't know, we're not mixing it enough. We're all in our groups. We're all in, and architecture is part to do with that, isn't it? I go out with some mates, and all they want to do is look at Georgian architecture. I'm going, oh, fuck, Georgian architecture. Do I really care? Do you know what I mean? And they go, oh, look,
but you know what the point is, you know what it is.
But it's not, no, because
No, I'm just saying, you can say, that's very privileged to be able to say Georgian architecture and know,
what do
well, at
le-
the very least, you know what it's not.
Yeah, I know what it's not. Yeah. I don't know if it's any good or not, but I know I've got mates who just keep dribbling about it. When you're out,
are they here?
No, they're not.
Well, we don't
no, they're not there. But so when we talk about Harlow, it's like we grew up. There was a town centre. We used to hang out in the town centre. It was really great. Every Saturday on the clock tower. Then they built the Harvey Centre, and we went, oh, this is great. But the town centre died in the Harvey Centre. And then they built this other thing up by the Pinnacles. So the Harvey Centre then dies. So the town centre's dead. Harvey Centre's dead. And then the Pinnacles is dead. And you go, what the fuck is happening? How is this? How are we supposed to be developed people allowing this mass? And it's all about separation. And so Harlow is quite important to me for that reason. It is important because it's like, wow, it enables me to be able to look at it in that way without being blindsided and go, oh, like this. But also understand how fortunate I am that I can almost have 2 feet, one in one world and one in the other world, or do you know what I mean? And be slightly messed up for it. So Harlow is important for that because there's a confidence it gives people, but there's another group of people that are constantly taking it away. In
but
You didn't ask me that. Okay. How does it influence my work? It might have messed my work up in one way. It's given me a confidence to go, I want to do this, and I want to do that. So I haven't actually gone through that threaded thing of going, you know, one thing and constantly going like that. I've been able to execute lots of different ideas. And that's a kind of confidence. And maybe it's a bad thing, because sometimes it's better to work, to have a problem and trying to keep to solve it and keep on it and keep pushing it and trying to expand space on your own problem, rather than going, okay, that's a problem. I've got another problem here, because, you know, and do that.
Why don't we use that to ask him what he's doing?
Yeah, how has this social crucible influenced your work? That you find yourself in the midst of it, coming from the RCA, fantastic school of sculpture, and you suddenly find yourself here, surrounded by some of the best buildings actually produced between about, well, they were on the drawing board about 1946 and built by 10 years later, in an environment that actually recognised the ability to walk through a new town and cycle through it, never had any idea how many motor cars would suddenly expand. You find yourself coming from this almost diametrically opposed environment, I guess, than the one we've here explained. They're not better than each other, they're very different. You find yourself here, you've been working for how long?
What?
Here,
yeah. A year and a half.
A year and a half?
Yeah.
And now you've produced this body of work that somehow has gone through your pores and come out. Tell us about it. That's what I want to know.
It's like, I think the thing that I have tried to do, which I think is a little bit about how you, that privilege that you maybe put upon yourself, is trying to see kind of a similar thing from the same perspective. And it was a bit like, I remember when I first emailed you, you said that this was the first place that you saw you realised that Henry Moore could also be a water fountain, and that was that. And there was also this similar understanding that, like, a lot of my work is about trying to work out where meaning gets embedded into material, and how movement is incorporated into that as well. And like, so this head is of a guy called Jimmy Johnson, who has been involved in a lot of art robberies or artifact robberies in Gloucestershire, and he
what do you mean he's been involved in?
So he's alleged that
is he a fable? Is he a tale, or is he a
he's real?
Okay, he's a real person, and he may or may not have.
He's been arrested enough times, but he's also been.
Violent to the mask. He's a robber.
Yeah, he's a robber, but he's got a really interesting way when he talks. He's got a really interesting way of understanding material and ownership and what public means and what private means, and he represents that way of seeing. You can see something as a lump of heavy material which you could melt down for something, for cash, or him actually going, oh, I quite like some of this stuff, and having a kind of aesthetic opinion on it. And I suppose...
Did you go to art school?
What?
Did you go to art school?
No. No, he's a gypsy. And he's part of a big gypsy family who are all involved in
music.
They were, I don't know. I've just read about it. He's a bit of a legend.
Yeah, he's a fable.
Yeah, he is. I mean, he represents that.
And did you take the Hepworth from Dulwich?
No, but
and did you take the Henry Moore from Barry Green?
I don't think he was involved in that. He was involved in trying, he's now working with the police to try and track down other Henry Moore's, Henry Moore, which has been stolen.
Just to follow that, but so that he's the most fabulous thing in the show then, isn't he? I mean, he's in the sense that because the show, for the greater part, is you being, you've had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very playful. I keep thinking it would be lovely if there were at least half of us were children, because I think they'd really get it. I think they'd really, you know, it's very, in some ways it's very, it's not instructive, but it's very, it reminds you, you can just put some concrete in a shoebox and that'll make something stand up. You know, it's
yeah.
that kind of, and it, I think it's a very, very pleasurable show to be in for that reason. But he's the exception, he's
yeah.
to me.
Yeah, I think he like counters everything else.
But when did he turn up?
He was in development alongside everything else, and I think he like it's very important to, I think it's always important to think about how long something's staying gonna be there for, and what you consider fixed in your environment, and that's why I've been really interested in looking at what sculpture means to people who are living amongst them. Because I couldn't say I really lived amongst sculpture. I mean, we had the clock tower at the top of our road, which got painted every like 6 years, which was quite, like I noticed that changed. And that was also a timepiece, which was quite funny. But it's kind of what, I kind of want to see everything. If you see everything as moving, then it frees up your ability to affect it, I think. And I remember, like, when we were at the, sorry, with my auntie Jo, when we were at looking at the marble columns with the geologist, the V&A, yeah. And the geologist seeing all of the, describing to us all the movement within their metamorphosization of the rock.
The invention of the rock.
Yeah, and this thing representing like stillness in a museum. And him seeing all of, like this column, which is like a symbol of stillness, and him seeing all of the movement within the rock as a material was really incredible. And then later understanding that that environment, that museum environment, was made for all the Renaissance art that was stolen. And so there's this like constant kind of, if you know enough about something, you can think about movement within anything. And I find that really interesting when looking at like sculpture in a traditional sense, and that's why I like screws so much and why I'm still holding this. And it's why I think shelves are good as well, because they hold moving objects, and that's what I put on the shelf. This is a like furniture screw, so it's got two.
Maybe you should pass that round.
Yeah.
That could make somebody go to art school.
It's, yeah.
In which case.
So you put that in the leg, and then the seat goes on that. So, yeah, I love it.
But I'd still, does he know he's here?
No, I couldn't contact him. He's moving around all the time.
Yeah, but you should mention what material is it made of?
Yeah, it's made of cast iron.
The origin?
No, because I think the material is very important.
Yeah.
In the why
yeah, cast iron is. This is actually came from an article that I think you wrote about.
Who's you?
Nick Smith. About the. Yeah, all my ideas are from you, right? About the replacement of Conrad Shawcross's sculpture of the stolen Barbara Hepworth. And it got me thinking about this cast iron is this public metal in that it's got a high melting point, it's cheap, and it's used in drains and benches, and so it's this public metal which is I mean it's hard to steal, you wouldn't steal it, no one steals drain Some people buy keys and steel drain covers.
I think it's useless for electronics.
It's useless for electronics, yeah, like
so
copper
its
and
value is
less.
I think there's something running around in here which I can't put my finger on, but it's something to do with value discuss and collective respect. So maybe I can do this by something that happened to me about a month ago. So I was having a kind of cold pizza lunch with half a dozen people in a gallery. And it was slightly shy. They were people who didn't always work together, but they were young. They were 25. And the biggest person there, physically, nearly as big as you.
Really?
Yeah, scary. was a guy called Gosha, who was, I suppose technically is Georgian, but he's came to New York when he was 11. And I didn't know him very well, but he carried this sort of strange morality with him, which was very, you could really feel, very, very nice quality, very nice thing to be near. Very, very gracious, very polite with a small p. And he, while we were all sitting, he was walking around the table and he said, can you believe that somebody would do this? And he described his neighborhood, which is probably in Brooklyn somewhere. And I think it involved the neighbors, so that can be us, getting together and planting things around the trees and making the street nice. Nothing, you know, we can discuss that if you want. But he said, why would some people come within a week and trash it? And he said, they've just been completely trashed. And he said, why? And he sort of rhetorically to the whole table, he said, why would you do that to your neighborhood? So somebody said, well, maybe they've never had anything of their own, and maybe they sleep three to a bed, and they don't know where belonging meets ownership, which is quite interesting that we say, we can use the word own, and it doesn't have to be always about property. And then somebody said, you know, some people just hate everybody, and you know, they see a flower and they want to stamp on it or whatever. So it was one of those sorts of conversations. You could overhear this on the bus, perhaps. And then two nights later, I was with an artist who you might know, who's got a funny name, called Theaster Gates, who works in Chicago, in the hardest, most beaten up piece of Chicago. And he said, no, the sort of people who do that are, and he had some American term for it, were sort of graduation ceremony stupidity, you know, Oxford students stomping on them. And so he turned the whole thing right up the other way. And he said, you can't make that. I'd reported the story to him, and he said, you can't make that judgment. And I think we don't really know how to talk about that space anymore. Which is like passing somebody else's, like I think the decorated car was a brilliant example, but the ways that people make the world and the funny little spaces between our allegedly private selves and the thing that we put out that is ambiguous, that may reach the next privacy, the next person's privacy. And I think that's it's a space where everyone here is in that space. We're all, you know, next to somebody else and not whatever. But it's in your daily, everyone's daily conduct. And I hear myself making radio for I've had the Radio 4 insert, you know.
Yeah.
It's just going to church, Radio 4.
Yeah,
it's quite simple.
I don't know how much.
What do you?
Yeah, I don't know how much we all do it, actually.
If somebody came in here and said, "What is all this old rusty iron stuck in that concrete? Isn't even hasn't even been floated off, and says, get this crap out of here or knocks it over."
Mm.
You know, it's happened to me.
Yeah.
That you would be mortified. So there's
we had an amazing chance to go to Cuba 2 years ago, and what you can see is everyone thinking through the materials and problem solving.
Because they've got absolutely fuck all.
Yeah, but they've also got...
They haven't got nails.
They've got fuck all of the same things, though. So they all problem solve in a different way, but out of similar materials.
Because you can have fuck all to the point where you get everything, where you have everything. Do you know what I mean? There is that measure, isn't it? That you can have fuck all, and there's a point like, you need a cup, but then you'll use your hands. Do you know what I mean? And if you haven't got that in hand, you'll find something else. Do you know what I mean? So the idea of what of having something, or where having nothing is, or where it's kind of a loop of itself, isn't it? I mean, we've known each other vaguely, but we know each other. I come down here the other week, and this is where I grew up.
Right, so I would say the first one. First.
What vaguely? What
the plates.
First time we met, I was trying to steal some plates. Outside, we were walking around Chelsea, there's all these plates stacked up. And I was looking up and going, God, this is so rich, this area. Look at the size of these plates. And then as we're about to steal them, he comes out. I go, hey, Cedric. I go, oh, hi. What the fuck? Can we give me my plates? You go, oh, they're yours. Okay. So we were trying to steal some plates. So
5 seconds, they were out there.
But we were just walking around. We got Victoria going, this is brilliant. And anyway,
about 60 plates.
We were going to be rich. It was brilliant. Anyway, so we'd seen these plates. We had a chat. We knew each other, blah, blah, blah. Then I come down here to drop something off. And he's in here. So I'm going, right, I grew up in Harlow. I come into the Harlow Gallery. And I go, hey, Sam, what are you doing? I've got a show. And then, how the fuck you got a show? You're not from Harlow. And then it's like, oh man, I'm so annoyed. What the hell haven't I got a show here? I'm thinking, it's like, what the hell's going on here? It's like, it's not from Harlow he's got a show. I'm from Harlow and I haven't got a show. And how does that work out? And so we have a bit of banter, and I drive home really angry. And going, oh, that's so fucking out of order. But I was thinking, we had a chat about the work, didn't we?
You were like, get rid of that.
I was going to get rid of that.
Did.
We were talking about the work destructively. And then tonight I came down and I was looking at the work again with Isolde. And I was going, I just love that piece there. The piece on the wall. And I don't know why I love it. And Isolde was going, because there's some balance. It's almost like that piece has turned into the other piece.
It's an equation.
But I couldn't work out what I could see. But Isolde saw it. She could see what I saw. But I couldn't work out. I was going, wow, as a sculpture, that's fucking everything, isn't it? It's got this thing's hanging, and then it's got this plinth with the edge of it, and it's got this moment, it's got this space behind it. And I was going, wow, you know, my parents would never have brought me here. This wasn't their deal. They weren't about it. But I'm kind of going, you know, thinking about it, going, wow, this is what's great about Harlow. Is that there's a whole lot of people that have the opportunity to bring their kids and to come in here and not like it. Like, I felt like we didn't have that space as a kid to come into a gallery and not even like it. Do you know what I mean? So I kind of thought that's been one of the benefits of having Finn here and seeing the work that I have had to rethink and go myself, okay, it's not your work, that's all right. You know, but I can get what it could, the possibility of him being here, and the possibility of another kid like me or something going, I don't get it, but what is it? And I'll think about it, or like it, or dislike it. I think that's what this show's done for me, in that sense. Some of the bits I think are really strong, some are not so strong, but I think it's the opportunity to be able to have that in this space. So I kind of think he's done You're right, for some reason. No, but even from Arlo, he's done really well. But he's kind of done, you know, for me, when I was looking at the show. But it is, there is something about the judgment we make and how we can't get away from that. And even me, I'm constantly, my kids will say, I'm so horrible. The other day, I'm in the car with my daughter, I see this woman, I say this comment as if, and my daughter hammers me. I'm literally, she's going, you
how
can't say 16,
to and what did you say?
I'm not even going to say what I said. But, and I was literally driving the car like this, going, oh God, you are so right. And it literally played on my head,
yeah.
You know. But it's that kind of possibility that you want your kids to have, and they get that. Art questions things. It has that ability to question things, and we never really had that. You know, we kind of grew up, we could still hit kids, which I still agree with, but we grew up with that, do you know what I mean? And so you could question things, you couldn't question anything. It was as it is.
My question to you is, why don't you live in Harlow now then?
Yeah, that's a good one.
Because he's got a studio in
Dagenham. No, why don't I live in Harlow now? I don't know, because I moved out of Harlow, my parents moved back to Jamaica. And then when I came back to England, I settled with my cousins in East London. And so I never, ever came back, funny enough.
Until tonight?
No, I've been back before, but yeah. But yeah, that was it. That's why I don't live in Harlow, I think.
Cedric, were you kind of aware of the sculpture collection when you were a kid? Were there any sculptures?
I was aware. Can I get that thing? Can I get that?
Yeah.
Is that right? I wasn't aware of a sculpture collection, but this was the first sculpture I remember seeing as a kid. And it's a sculpture at the at Staple Tire, there's a shopping area. And I remember walking with my mum one day going, what is that? And my mum going, I don't know. And going, well, you're my mum, you know, in your head, your mum knows everything. And she goes, I don't know. And I'm just going, what is that? And then going shopping and walking back from Staple Tire going, mum, what is that? She goes, I don't know, why they put it down? You know, and that for me was, you know, it's, and then I got asked to curate a show about video, and I don't like video, so I put that on the cover. So I didn't understand video, but I didn't understand at the time. I didn't understand that sculpture. So I wasn't aware of the collection.
Yeah.
I've learned more about it since I've been outside of Harlow, funny enough, than I have been when I was in Harlow. I mean, even Richard Tonight educated me massively on some of the Henry Moore stuff that I didn't know. You did. You told me things I didn't know. That's massive where I grew up.
Yeah, educate's a big word.
Okay, yeah. I can spell it though.
He shared a few things with me.
So yeah, so I wasn't aware, and I don't know why that was. Kevin, were you aware of the sculpture in Harlow when you were a kid?
Yeah, they mentioned it. And the one in the paddling pool.
Yeah.
Pool at the town centre. I always swear we've been climbed on it, God knows how many times.
Yeah.
Not a collection, but it's like your individual ones.
Different part of Harlow.
Yeah, it's not like the same thing, but you know that one.
The first time I remember seeing it, actually, or recognising it, was rolling down the hill naked and seeing my teacher at the bottom of the hill. This sculpture was there. I'm not sure if it's still there.
No, it's not.
He's got it.
it's something else.
But
can you say something about your experience of working with the kids in Harlow?
Yeah, so that, like I said, it kind of started off as a... I thought it was going to be really hard, and it was in that I don't understand how teachers, I mean maybe they don't, but there's so many different ideas and standpoints from such a young age. I couldn't believe how they attacked the same task in so many different ways. And so if there's any freedom in a lesson, that produces like however many kids like going in different directions, and you going like, is this good, is this bad? Like, should I tell them stop doing it? And
so the form, did they
the
come
form,
to you for an hour?
Yeah, so there were two things. I did two workshops at Harlow College, where they it's not called just art anymore. They've combined it with some other
agriculture,
science and stuff. But
what was the physical circumstances?
So I did it. The workshop was on Art at Itil, which means useful art, which is started by Tanya Bagheera, and I wanted to use that as a method of getting to think about how art could be active, and I thought that was quite good within a workshop and talking about work, because it was all kind of examples from around the world where there's a valley in Iceland which never has any sun because it was built there for mining purposes, but people still live there. And so an artist builds a mirror on the hillside to give them light, that kind of thing. And that was really amazing, like in terms of them going, what are our problems? How can we solve it creatively? Then the second workshop was with a primary school, and that was...
And you went to them, or they came?
I went to them, and that was to... We did a kind of relay, so they all had sculptures from Harlow on their chests. No, three of them had sculptures from Harlow on their chests.
Are they printed?
Facing the other...
Physically
yeah.
attached?
No, they're printed, and they were standing facing the wall, and then they got into three teams, and they had to run round and look at it and get as much information as they could while running. And then they had to draw them. So all of those artworks are drawn from memory. And it was amazing because like some of them started drawing the outline first and then colouring in. And some of them were just using the paint to like push out, shutting their eyes and push out like a line from the centre, which felt my way more like they were making it almost. And then in terms of what they saw, the surroundings, like the... One of the images was Rodin's Eve, and there's a pizza hut behind it, and the first thing all of the kids drew was a pizza at the time. So that obviously, I mean, maybe that's an obvious image thing in terms of recognition, but some didn't even draw the sculpture, they just drew a pizza hut. And then after that we played hopscotch, because I wanted them to get them to start thinking about following an object. Is everyone allowed to play hopscotch? I mean, it's played all around the world in different ways, and we looked at different courts, but they made their little shooter out of plaster, and plaster you can draw with as well. It's like chalk. So they made their shooters, and then it was the idea of like how you follow objects, and then when you get into each square, like what are your instructions? So they expanded on that, and some of them wrote like crazy things, like once you're in this, then you've got to eat five oranges. And then we take.
Do you think that you've become a bit of a you sound like you've become very confident at doing it, which I think is brilliant, because I think actually just children are bloody brilliant. So and yeah. We're very if you're not a child, you're very lucky to be anywhere near them. But is this now a bit infectious? I mean, are you the Pied Piper?
Yeah, I mean, it's really nice to leave. When you see like coming in and being the front workshop is something which take for granted. like doing it day in, day out is so hard, I can imagine.
I think that should be a public war memorial. I think it's amazing.
And so, and the difference in their approach was something I did not expect from such a young age. I mean, maybe your differences in approach gets squashed as you get older.
Were they your students?
No.
No, she just asked the question.
I can remember that.
And here you were actually working with a group of people who actually live in Harlow.
not much that much different from, they're just human beings.
I don't feel like I've got any kind of social commentary about Apollo kids in particular. It was just the kids. But the one thing which was particular is this understanding of sculpture as a word, and like we went through it in art school continuously. Like, why are there departments? Why is there sculpture? Why is there painting? Why is there printmaking? We're all artists. Why can't I make things? But what was argued in Counter was sculpture's a word which people, you can rebel against or work towards, or but at least it has some, it's a starting point to then to work with, if not anything else. And
the reason they have departments is they can have more professors.
Yeah, but I actually believe in departments. Controversial.
But I think the great thing about the workshop that Finn did was the fact that you actually gave them lots of perspectives. A lot of them didn't know the sculptures, hence doing the signs of the piece art, which actually isn't there anymore, so it's a whole picture.
It's Chandler's or something,
or Five Guys.
They learned
about those two things, about, you know, they mixed those disciplines. So they did the painting, then they made the sculptures, and then they made something they could draw with. And when they came here on the Saturday for the presentation, to, you know, sort of, they brought everybody with them. But the great thing about Finn was that they looked literally looked at him, obviously it's so cool. But actually, so I never met a real artist before. And they remember now being in the centre of Harlem, actually being involved with that very short workshop. It was about 3 hours, didn't it?
Yeah.
And then having their work presented, but actually seeing you again and all you produced. And I think they've talked about it ever since, about comments from the teachers and, you know, saying that they just thought it was a magical thing. It just shows how rare it is in schools now, that they actually get to make things and make a mess and do things that, in a short time, that excite them so much. I think it was brilliant. You were really good.
Well, yeah, I think that idea of, like, looking forward is really important. I think that's what's going to be really good about this. The idea of this project is it's going to be 10 years. Good luck. But like the idea is that there's going to be some building of momentum within.
It's similar to what Cedric said about what Corinne's just said, is I'm really happy that you went up the motorway, you went home really angry, because you came away with emotion.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's nice you've come back and do.
I think we're gonna wrap it up there, but is there any questions for, I mean, in terms of us, we're gonna stop talking.
I've got a really odd question for you.
Yeah.
Did you feel safe and comfortable in Harlow?
I was at a gatehouse, and there was, I mean, when I was there, there was stuff in the papers about, I mean, it was like similar to like Brexit time, and there was some attacks on the Polish community, I think, and it so didn't give me the, it wasn't like the warmest welcome in terms of mentally, but I walked from my studio to the train station every other day and felt, yeah, really safe. I mean, I haven't had any trouble whatsoever.
Why did you ask that question?
Well, I've been here for a long time, and I bring people up to the gallery quite often. And as I was walking around, I didn't feel safe in the gallery. I didn't feel safe near the sculptures. I had to be careful where I was walking in case I tripped over. And I thought, well, you can't. It was a very odd time when the Polish man was killed.
Mm.
But generally, Harlow is a very safe place, but I didn't feel safe around these sculptures.
I think that's the most brilliant thing I've heard in a public space for 100 years. I mean, I think, because I think the decorum in galleries, I mean, I go to galleries quite a lot, but I don't like the feeling of the decorum. I don't like.
No.
And if I go to a big exhibition, I always walk right through it to the end, find out how big it is, and then walk back and sort of decide how I want to use my time, because I don't like feeling that I'm being sort of led by the nose, you know, and I find myself in some queue to read it, whatever. I'm not saying I do it well, but I try and beat the system, and I think it is I don't think he'd mind me saying this, but there's a man on the board at the Tate who's a very intelligent architect called Stephen Witherford, and he was a Cambridge architecture student, and he was 24 at that point, and somebody said, we're going to go to see the Max Ernst show tomorrow. And Stephen said, what's that? And somebody said, oh, he's a dead German artist, we're going to wherever it was. And he'd never been to a gallery until he was 24, and he was at Cambridge doing architecture. Mm-hmm. And he, if he was here, he'd tell it himself. And it's incredibly humbling, but of course, partly why it's humbling is because of the decorum, and I think what you've just described is a very complicated thing about the, and we were laughing about it downstairs, about the manners, the implicit manners that these are publicly owned, or we're in, it's a different kind of public space, very distinct kind of public space.
I think that's the important thing about the sculptures in Harlow, though, because when you go into when you go into an area and the kids don't know that it's precious, and they're climbing all over it.
Exactly.
I work in the Stowe, and I've got Chiron right outside where I work, and there's a few parkourers who come and leap over it, and I think it's fantastic. I think that's what it's, that's partly what it should be there for. And my husband grew up here, he was born here, grew up here, and he talks about the sculptures in that way. Oh yeah, we always used to go there and sit on that one, and that was the one that you could get really high on, and things like that. And I think it, I think the sculptures were put in public places not to be kind of looked up to, although some of them are worth millions and all of that now, but when they were first put in situ, but the Hepworth one definitely is.
Imagine, just to do with this sort of time loop, I know we're ending, but imagine if the people who would have perhaps been, in those comments, like us, who made those decisions, so what is that, 80 years ago, well, the germ of that decision is 80 years ago, so the action is 60 years ago. Imagine if they heard what you just said. I mean, how fabulous to be rewarded in that way by that kind of by experience.
Yeah, I mean, I think I work with a theatre group in Harlow as kids, and they did a show recently in the Playhouse about Harlow and the future of it and what has been the past. And there was just this wonderful bit when one of them was being Frederick Gibbard with Lady Gibbard having a bit of a chat, and she was telling him off, and their view of what Harlow was and why they built it. And they were all really happy and dancing in the past, and yeah, I think that's what it's about. And I think that's what art should be in this town particularly, and that's what hopefully it's going to be more of, because the young people are the people that are missing often. Mm. The kids are often missing. Mm. And that's changing.
Yeah.
We're going to put you on the Tate board.
I think that's where the idea that this space makes you feel a bit like it's dangerous or like something can fall on you. I quite like that. But I also, in terms of what you were saying, you need to, especially as a kid, you need to understand that if you fall over and because you climb too high, that's your fault, and you might not climb so high next time. And the show name came from where I used to work at a art handling company, and we were moving a massive crate and we didn't know what was in it, so it was all about weight. It was a piece of art inside, and we knew it was valuable, but we didn't know what it was, and it was massive. But we were still considered more important than it, in that they said, like, if it starts to fall, move out of the way. They just said that, like, you're more important than this material, even though this is really important. So it was that boundary of, like, is it going to kill you? And if it is, move. But if you can just save it, then hold it. And that is, an important space to, like, position stuff. you so much for coming, everyone, and to these two guys, it has been an absolute pleasure to be sick. Like, this is my absolute dream. Like, you don't understand. It's massive, massive.
No, I would just say, I think it's amazing. As I came on the train and I thought, God, before Christmas, I've done a couple of things. I've once actually done something like this with one person in the audience. I've actually talked to one person, and by the way, don't do that. Say, would you like to go for tea? Just don't. I imagine that maybe there would be, I don't know, I didn't imagine the family factor, which is brilliant, but I sort of thought maybe there would be 15 people and it would be uncomfortable and slight, and I didn't know what the space would be at all. And I think this is just. Well, I did have, I've got a cold ass. I just think it's really fantastic that everybody came, and that is its own meaning, because gathering, we've just actually just forgotten how to gather. Mm. You know, it's very, very ordinary and very old, and we don't do it. It's really, really fantastic. You're gathering. This is exactly, precisely.
Come to the opening of the open. And you'll see a whole different crowd.
I'll come more often.
Thank you.
Thank you.